When a soldier gives his life for the country, does anybody say that, oh, he's so irresponsible, he knew he has a young wife? They say, oh, such a great, such a valiant soldier, you know, he has sacrificed his family for the country and this and that, and he's a big martyr. And then why? Why do the devotees get all the flack?
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna.
Should a person join the movement, leaving his college, or should he wait and complete his graduation? So first thing first, what do the scriptures say? Actually, the scriptures say that university or the school that is currently existing in the education system, it's not at all authorized. A totally unauthorized system of education that does not give us even perfect material knowledge. And to add to that, there is absolutely no spiritual knowledge. And even the material knowledge that they're learning is not perfect. So this education system is entirely flawed from the spiritual point of view. It's entirely flawed. The actual education system is the Gurukul system, the Vedic Gurukul system. But the Vedic system was abused by the so-called Brahmanas, which resulted in its abolishment from the entire society. So replacing that was this British system of education that was introduced in India, and pretty much that has been the norm now all over the world. And the whole education system is based on just material, learning some material things, and that too in an imperfect way, according to what the scientists say and according to our experimentation in that. So first of all, that whole system is flawed because there is no God consciousness. Whereas the Vedic Gurukul system is so perfect that the child, from the very tender age of 5 years old, he is sent to the Gurukul and he learns about Krishna, Supreme Personality of Godhead, and he also learns about all the things in the world, but in relation with God, not separately or independent or in isolation from God. He learns it in connection with God. So it's not that our Vedic system does not have, you know, brilliant science and all that. In fact, Vedic science is far more brilliant than the modern science. The yogis, they could do far, far superior things than what the modern scientists can achieve. But it's not about just whether we can do it, but also there were systems in place who should do it. For example, now, you know, broadcast over television or over the internet, like now what we are doing as a live stream, like this, big events are broadcasted, like sports matches and, you know, big events. Previously, not everybody had access to such facility, but a select few, like Sanjaya, he could have that facility of receiving the broadcast, live broadcast from Kurukshetra. The war was going on, and by Vyasadeva's mercy, he could see the live broadcast from Kurukshetra, and he could narrate it to Dhritarashtra. Live commentary he was giving. So this is unheard of in our present context. But they do have the broadcast with the radio waves and all this, you know, television signals and internet and all this. So now everybody can do it, because the millions of people, they are usually not spiritually inclined. So they will use that same power for watching something which is not spiritual. Whereas Sanjaya saw Krishna and whole Kurukshetra war and Bhagavad Gita. So the purpose was totally different. So qualified people were given such power. Now every unqualified rascal is given such power and he misuses. Because once you join up, then you can make your life successful, and then you can preach and then make others' life successful. Big doctors, big people, big engineers, big scientists, their lives are depressed. So they require spiritual knowledge. Everybody requires spiritual knowledge. Nothing else will save. So actually, this is the prime importance. We don't even know whether we will last until the graduation. What if I die before graduation? So if I wait for graduation and then join, you know, what may happen? And even if I did stay alive, time is wasted in fruitless endeavor in learning for this graduation. Yes, it is said we have to obey our parents and all that, but the parents have to obey the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Then obeying the parents will make sense. Like the classic example is Raghunath Das Goswami. Among the six Goswamis, the direct disciples of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Raghunath Das Goswami's father was a Vaishnav. He was always serving the Vaishnavas, always having, you know, feeding the Vaishnavas. Very, very wealthy man. But when his own son became Vaishnava, he employed so many bodyguards, dozens of bodyguards to, you know, not to save him his wealth, not to save his son from thieves, no, but to make sure that his son doesn't go away. They are not there to catch thieves, you know, they are there to catch his own son from running away from the movement, because he just did not care. Raghunath Das Goswami did not even care for his father's wealth, or they got him married to a very, very beautiful girl, very extremely beautiful girl. He was not interested. He was sleeping outside in the veranda of the house, just waiting when, you know, there will be an opportunity to run to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And it may sound like, oh, that's not being responsible, you know, he's family man, and, you know, how can he run away like that? That's not a proper example. Well, what is the proper example? What is the proper example? To be just rot in this material world? So when the acharyas do that, when great devotees, they do that, morally it may sound, oh, not so, you know, nice. But because it's for a transcendental cause, we cannot judge it on the material, on the lower level of judgment. For example, when a soldier dies for his country, we cannot condemn the soldier saying, oh, he neglected his family, he had two young children. Does anybody ever say that? When a soldier gives his life for the country, does anybody say that, oh, he's so irresponsible, he knew he has a young wife and he knew he has two young children and one of them is just a few months old and he went to the border and, you know, fought for the country, what is this? You know, he should have been more responsible towards his family. Does anybody ever say that? They say, oh, such a great, such a valiant soldier, you know, he has sacrificed his family for the country and this and that, and he's a big martyr. And then why do the devotees get all the flack? When they give their lives up for not just the country, but for the whole world. Bhutva dina ganesha kau karunaya kaupina kanthashritav. The six Goswamis, they gave their life for what? They gave up their tyaktva turunam asesha mandalapati shrenim sada tuchavat. Tuchavat means as if they were like insignificant things, they gave up. And what did they give up? Their established positions as great government officers, huge personalities in the society. Big shots. They were absolute big shots. And they gave up all that and then became mendicants. Now, that sounds very, oh, he has given up his responsibility, you know, this is become a, you know, a nobody, wasted his life, became crazy. Materialists will put all these labels. But they gave their life for the biggest cause. If country is bigger than a family, and if we can recognize that, why can't we recognize that God, who is the owner of not only all countries, but all planets and all universes and all the whole material world and the spiritual world, aham sarvasya prabhavo matta sarvam pravartate, and if we give our lives for him, why should that be condemned? This is absolute rubbish, okay? Rubbish behavior by so-called materialists. They don't understand. So sometimes you try to make them understand, you can tell them until you die, but they will never listen. So leave the whole place and come out. Eventually they may understand or may not understand. But we cannot waste our life on somebody else's terms. Now, let's leave about Krishna consciousness. Sometimes the boy or a girl leaves the family just because, you know, he wants to marry someone. Now the boy wants to marry a girl, or the girl wants to marry a boy. The family doesn't agree. And then they leave the family and then go and, you know, marry themselves. So then they say, oh, that is the, you know, victory of love and all kind of, you know, nonsense. And what about when we're giving for the Lord, when I'm giving our life for the Lord? And the Lord is our actual mother and father. Don't forget that. This mother and father is for this body. Last life we had another set of mother and father. Before that another set of mother and father. Janame janame sab pita mata paaye guru krishna nahi mere bhaja hari aaye. So guru and krishna we cannot get every moment, every life, but every life we will get father and mother. Even we are, you know, worm in the stool, we will have father and mother. So mother and father is, we have to respect them. You know, I'm not saying we should not, but they also should do their duty. Like Prahlad Maharaj, did he respect his father? Yes. Because he saw his father also as a servant of Krishna, he respected him. He never, you know, chastised him or something. He always spoke with respect. But at the same time, he did not obey him.